We were actually studying about the economic survey volume 1, and in the past 2 weeks we have covered somewhere around like 8 chapters, and today we are going to continue the volume 1, and we are trying to finish volume 1 by learning the 3 more chapters, which is about the privatization, which is chapter number 9. And chapter 10 will be upon like whether the GDP growth calculations, which is done in India, the methodology and the other data sources, are they all like correct? Because there is a question which is looming around saying like the GDP growth rate is not calculated in a proper way, or it is overestimated. So in order to address that particular question, survey has dedicated a chapter, and it is much more econometrically oriented to prove the point that the clarification about the GDP calculations is actually correct. Then the last chapter will be about the Thalinomics, which is about the food inflation and how the food prices have actually changed over a period, and whether it is affordable to the people or not. So these are the 3 chapters which we are going to see as part of today's class. In the subsequent class, in the next week, we'll be starting with volume 2, and we may be requiring like 2 sessions to complete volume 2. So today we are going to continue with the volume 1, chapter 9. From the beginning in the economic survey, they had been talking about like wealth creation, and we have seen so many evidences like by what ways and all we'll be able to create wealth in the country, right from entrepreneurial activity, doing the business activity. So there are lots of things which have contributed, and now they want to say privatization is also a way how we can actually create more wealth in the country. So they are doing some economic analysis, like doing the comparison of the companies which were there with the government and which were like privatized. And here they are making use of the word strategic disinvestment, because the percentage is slightly higher than this 51%. So strategic disinvestment is the word which they are continuously using throughout the chapter to describe that private sector is more in proportion and compared to the public sector in holding of a particular company, and how the company has performed after this kind of a strategic disinvestment. So the chapter goes on with the elaborate evidence of comparing the companies which have undergone strategic disinvestment. They have picked up a particular period, say for example 1999-2002-2003-04. So they have picked up like 11 these public sector enterprises, and they are comparing with comparable peers in their own areas, like in whichever sector they belong to. They have given a table in which they have explained like the comparable peers, how they have performed before and after this strategic disinvestment, right? So we are going to see through this chapter the importance of doing privatization, and after privatization how the companies have performed, and whether it is useful in creating the wealth or not. And the important point what they want to say is those which were privatized in this period of 1999 to like this 2003-04, they were all like belonging to the non-priority sectors or low priority sectors. Usually the government has the policy of retaining the strategic sectors and the priority sectors with themselves. So here we are going to see that the low priority sectors, which can be privatized, they are the ones which have been like given for the privatization, and how they have performed is what we are going to see through this chapter. So this is one recent example which they have compared between BPCL and HPCL. Some from the BPCL, 52.39%, more than 52%, they have now gone ahead for the strategic disinvestment. Whereas HPCL is still under the government control. So after the disinvestment, you can see here, it is given through a dotted line where you can see that the prices of the stock of the BPCL has actually started increasing, or the equity value, the share value of the BPCL, because it has been strategically disinvested. Before this disinvestment, they both were like almost in the same pattern, whereas there is a huge difference between the stock prices between HPCL and the BPCL. You can see that the blue line is the BPCL and the red line is the HPCL. So this is taken as one of the first evidences to show that how like people regain confidence in the public sector enterprises when the private sector is taking over the the performance part of it, and then it is attempting to improve the efficiency of it. And this is one of the tables which a survey is presenting to compare between those periods like 1999, 2002, 2003, 2004. So these are the 11 public sector enterprises which were undergoing strategic disinvestment, and comparing with with its peer groups in the same particular industry group. And with these two set of things, they have given lots of evidences to us to say that how things have improved for the privatized public sector enterprise. So let's go and see some of the evidences, how they have improved. All these privatized firms will be the group of this 11 things. And then the average of the peer means the peer will be the average of all these 32 firms. So now you can see net worth, you can see after the privatization. So you can see the green color being pre-privatization and the red color or the orange color being the post-privatization. So everywhere in this, you have to consider this as the impact of pre and post. Here they are just continuing as the government's thing, though the 32 companies which are still under the government's holding. So you can see that the privatized firms have improved their net worth to a very larger extent after the privatization. So if you want to see the details, there is a table over there for that net worth. So which is defined as the equity plus profit retained as reserves. So equity will be the capital, the share capital, as well as the paid up capital, like initially with which they started and how they have raised through the equity. And whatever profit every year they are earning, some part of it will be reserved as the retained as the reserves. So they have given the overall data, and they say combined average of all privatized firms, pre and the post average, they are giving a number, and combined average of peer firms. So in the subsequent two periods, comparable periods, they are giving a number for the 32 firms which are still under the government. And they are seeing the difference in the difference. You know that 2290 is way high above 1290, but that is what they are presenting here as DID. This word DID refers to difference in difference. So they are seeing that it's not only a comparison between the pre and the post of the concerned firms, it is also the final difference between the total value. So which you can see definitely the net worth of the privatized firms are way high above the peer firms. Coming back to this diagram, which is again about the net profit, the second thing. Here also you can see the privatized firms are having very high net profits when compared with the peer firms. Net profits will be after all the expenses and profit of the company after paying the taxes also. So you pay out for all the operating expenses and you pay the taxes, after which you will be retained with the final amount, which will be the profit for that particular year. So you can see overall they have combined the average of all the privatized firms and for the pre and the post average, and you can see that the difference is 454 crores of rupees, whereas it is for the peer firms, it is only 154. So again, there is a huge difference between the difference in the difference methodology, where they try to prove that the privatized firms are way high above the peer firms. Coming back to that diagram, gross revenue will be the total receipts. Net profit is after paying the expenses and after paying the taxes, whereas gross will be before all those things. So here also you can see that the privatized firms are having a higher revenue. And return on assets, this will be, you can see that for the privatized firms, which were even very less on the negative side, they turned into positive side. Whereas for the peer firms, it is not like continuously increasing. It has even declined after the that particular period, like 2003-04. So now if you go and see the definition of what is this return on assets, it will be that profit after taxes divided by the average assets of the company. So how much total assets the company is having, and then how much profit is it like making year after year. So that is given as a return on the assets. And you can see that it has moved from negative side to the positive side. And the next parameter what we are going to see is return on equity. So which will be taken as profit after taxes to the average net worth. We have already defined what is net worth. So this net worth is becoming the denominator here. And you can go back and see the performance. You can see that the return on equity has also improved after privatization. It has improved for the other CPSEs, but it is very less when compared with the improvement of what the privatized firms have shown in the corresponding period, right? So here also we can see, so the assets are performing well, the equity has started performing well, and the net profit margin, the profit margin will be presented as the net profit or what we call as the profit after taxes to the total income. So the denominator will be the total income. And here you can see that it is slowly becoming positive, whereas for the peer groups, it is still remaining negative, right? So overall, in all these six diagrams, we are seeing one evidence that after the privatization, the privatized firms are showing very good performance when compared to the peer groups, which are continuing to be under the government's hold. Here we can see that number of employees are also like, they are actually declining in terms of the privatized companies. There could be issues in this considering the number of employees in the reduction of it. But I think in terms of improving the efficiency, they might have compromised on the number of employees, but there is not a very drastic difference between these two things. But when you are comparing with the peer firms who had been under the government's thing, you could see that the number of employees recruitment maybe would have been reduced. They were not performing that much efficiently. So they may not be having enough profits to pay the salary, and therefore the number of employees recruitment also came down drastically in terms of the peer firms. And then when you're looking at the sales growth, privatized firms, though they are not showing very high growth in the post-pay period, they are definitely showing a sales growth rate. Whereas when you're comparing the peer firms, though the sales growth may be looking higher the pre-privatization period, they haven't improved very drastically after the period of analysis, because they are still continuing under the holding of the government itself. And finally, you look at the gross profit per employee. So this is like per person we are seeing, because there are less number of people here, but there will be higher profits. Here you can see that the gross profit per employee is actually very high when compared with the peer firms who are still continuing with the public sector, right? So all of these graphs are showing you the evidence that in terms of the profit, in terms of equity, in terms of like profit after the taxes and per employee, in every aspect the privatized firms are doing very well. So the same the data presentation has also been given in terms of the graphical presentation. The first graph is to show that the net worth of the privatized firms are increasing. And the second thing is the net profit is also increasing. The gross revenue is increasing. And in case of the return on assets, it is slowly becoming higher than the peer firms. And in terms of gross profits, definitely it is higher than the peer firms. and gross profit per employee, it's showing a huge difference between the peer firms and the privatized firms. So the chapter is actually taking us forward to say that the strategic disinvestment or the privatization has actually proved improvement in the performance, overall productivity. So the competition levels have increased and there has been an increase in the professionalism in the management. So now they are suggesting yet another structure how they can actually go ahead for the strategic disinvestment, because it shows like good results in terms of the performance and in the productivity. So the current structure is something like this. The government and the private sector. So government will be holding more than 52% and private will be less than 49%. So only when this percentage changes, then they will be slowly moving towards the strategic disinvestment. But slowly they are changing the percentages and they are taking towards the disinvestment and reducing the government stake into it. So now they are suggesting, why don't we create a new entity? It's like a new overarching company, which will be taking up all the companies from the government, which is under the public sector enterprises, and then slowly make the private sector to have more than 51% and reduce the government's participation in it less than 49%. So this is where we exactly start calling it as a strategic disinvestment. And then this entity can be taking over the process of the disinvestment and see how this can be made successful in order to make these companies to perform better in the future. So this is the proposition which the survey is wanting to tell us as a result of the chapter, which is talking about privatization and wealth creation. So the wealth creation is seen here in terms of the parameters of the net profit, the net profit margin, the gross profit, this return on assets, return on equity. So these are all the parameters which are taken now to show as an evidence for better wealth creation in the country. Right. So that is this ninth chapter. If anybody is wanting to ask any doubts, you can type the question. Else, we move on to the next chapter. Why they are comparing private firms versus average of peer firms, not as average of private firms now? See, actually, averages only will be compared with the averages of other things. Probably. We can say that you go back and look at this table. In this table, you will see, like, assume it is Hindustan Zinc, which is privatized, but you have peer groups, two, three things. So Hindustan Zinc value will be one company's value, which will be compared versus the three companies. So here it becomes average of the three companies, which is compared with the value of the one company. So that's why you can say that you're comparing the private firm with the versus the average of the peer firms. When you talk about the net profit margin, see, everywhere the denominator keeps changing. We gave you the formula. The first thing we said, net worth. Net worth is to say, like, how much equity do we have plus whatever the profits which we have retained every year. Then we said about the net profit. Net profit will be the gross revenue minus the operating expenses or all the expenses which you have incurred in a particular year and the taxes. So finally, we are going to call it as the profit after taxes. Gross revenue, I told you, that's like the total revenue which has been received in a particular year. We have talked about the return on assets and return on equity with the formula, where for the return on assets, it will be the denominator will be the net worth. Return on equity, you're going to say, like, how much equity or the capital which you have formed and how much returns. We can even see the formula if you want. So it is the average of the assets of the company for the return on assets and average net worth. So how much returns have you already made over the period of time in terms of, like, net worth. Net worth will be having that equity capital. So that's why we put here, in order to see how much profit are you making in a year, to see the return on equity, right? Whereas if you look at the net profit margin, here they want to say what is this profit after taxes divided by the total income of the company. So that is the formula for this net profit margin. Total income of the company is nothing but your gross revenue, which is why the percentage looks very small. You can see from this diagram, as the denominator is increasing, the value, the answer will become lesser. So you're going to put that here to the gross returns, and the percentage is actually positive, but it is very small. So that is your net profit margin. Ma'am, does the peer firms are the one which is still under government? Yes, that's what we want to mention, like which are still under the government versus the privatized firms. What is the new entity in the proposed structure? They have not mentioned a name to the entity, but they are wanting to create some like one overarching structure. CB usually will have RBI as on the top for the supervision and regulation of all the banks. But maybe for the NBFCs monitoring, we can create a structure and monitor them. Similarly, they are wanting to have an apex body here to manage all this disinvestment. Instead of considering the ministry or the department of the government itself, they want to put up a new entity over there. Named the entity, or they have not mentioned about the full powers of it. How the new entity will be regulated? Of course, there will be members from the ministry as well as from the government who can become part of this particular new entity. It won't be totally autonomous. It will be still under the government with roles and responsibilities given to it. Under what circumstances will the government think about opting for disinvestment? We had mentioned a lot of like financial parameters over there, like return on equity, return on assets. So the performance of the company over a longer period of time, maybe they can take it under consideration. And if it is actually not doing very well, particularly the equity thing will show you a lot. And the returns on equity are actually doing bad, as well as the return on assets are all doing bad. Bad means on the negative side. That's when like mostly the government will decide, but it is actually a policy decision of the government. They should see like whether it is a strategic sector, sensitive sector, or it is a low priority sector. We already said like those which are coming for these kinds of strategic disinvestments will be the low priority sector. So depending upon the nature of the sector, depending upon the nature of the performance, these are the reasons how the government can think for disinvestment. If you want to ask about difference in difference methodology once more, let us say like we had a particular company which was actually undergoing disinvestment. And we have another company which is still under the government. So what we are trying to see is how is the disinvested company's performance before and after, and how this peer group is performing throughout the period. But we are taking this year as a benchmark, and we are saying how did it perform before and after. So we are seeing pre and post. So that's one way of looking at the analysis. But to continue and complete this analysis, the final thing what we can do is the pre and the post values of these two companies, one which got disinvested, one which is still under the government, you can see the difference of these two companies in order to understand the magnitude by which this privatized firm is now performing very well, right? So one is taken like the normal thing, which is continuing in its own stream, which is your the peer firms. One which has undergone a change, so pre and post change and comparison between these two things. So myself, comparison of myself before and after the change, and comparison of myself with the peer group. So that last comparison with the peer group is what is defined here as difference in difference. So first my difference before and after is the difference. Similarly, the peer group before and after will be having its own difference. And then difference in the difference. Our both comparison differences, what will be finally said as a difference in difference methodology. Finally, when we can take from this, is it government firms are underperforming or privatized firms are overperforming? We need not call privatized firms as overperforming. Rather, we can say like, we can see an improvement in the performance of the private sector. Of course, government firms are underperforming, Because to the extent of employees, what they have, they should have actually done a very good job. To the extent of resources, to the extent of capital, what they have had, they should have done a good job, which they are not doing. Shall we consider privatization will increase unemployment based on number of employees graph? This is a well-known fact. Of course, privatization will do a bit of a layoff. But this graph is not so discouraging because we don't see that much of a reduction in the levels of employment. But the kind of profits which are made have hugely increased. Whereas you can see even from the government's graph in this particular case of comparison, there was a reduction in the levels of employment. So in this case, in the evidence, whatever is given through the survey, we can see actually the number of employees who have come down in the companies which were continuing under the public sector itself has fallen down. So we are not like criticizing the private sector much based upon the evidence given. But generally, when you go for the concept of privatization, of course, there will be reduction in the levels of employment, particularly to improve the competitiveness and the efficiency. What does peer firm mean? Peer firm means comparable firms. Like we showed in that particular table, who are the companies which can be compared with a particular industry group. So we had the peer groups. The third column of this will be the comparable companies will be called as the peer group. The number of employees have come down, but profit for the private entity has gone up. How can it be an argument in favor of privatization? See, sometimes we need to accept that if there are like 10 people and if they are not very efficient in doing things, but the same work can be done efficiently with 8 people or 7 people, that is what we would like to have it, because anybody who is wanting to survive in a particular environment should be having enough efficiency and the skills which are required to that. It shouldn't be that I'm getting my salary and my job is secure, so I don't have to perform. So that should not be the thing, which is why we always see that the private sector employees' efficiency levels are always slightly higher than the public sector because of the lethargy which is setting into the people. It's not that they don't know how to do it, it's just that they don't do it properly. So, right? So that's what they are trying to do right now. Profits of the private sector will definitely go higher because of the improvement in the technologies which they will quickly decide, or the efficiency with which they do the things, the management with which they manage the things. All those things will be a bit different when compared with the public sector. So here, in terms of the net worth created, the profits created, we can say that privatization is a way how you can actually improve the wealth creation for the country. Should everything be privatized? All those questions are not being brought into this particular context. We are only thinking about those kind of public sector enterprises which are starting to incur losses. Can we improve them by doing privatization to them, right? Are the employees affected because of privatization? Yes, not all the employees will be affected. There will be some layoff. There are lots of social security measures which have to be given to the employees. If the private sector refuses to give the social security measures, then also the employees will get affected. But the government can ensure, like through the policy measure when it is going for the disinvestment, strategic disinvestment, the measures should be continued, and the security, the social security measures of the employees should be protected. These kind of policy things or the terms and conditions, with these things, the government can go ahead with the privatization. The resultant structure is only to create a new way how you can look at it. They are wanting some new autonomous entity, but still it will be having the government's role into it. It's basically they are saying, like, instead of the government directly, the ministry directly getting involved in this disinvestment, there can be a newer top structure which can be implementing this concept of strategic disinvestment, analyzing the companies, which are all the companies which should be strategically disinvested, how do we go ahead for this, and how do we improve the performance. So all of these functions can be entrusted to this new entity, right? how much percentage government share will be sold under strategy? More than 51% will be sold under the strategic disinvestment, or how much share the government will hold after. So if it is more than 51%, it will be less than 49% or 49%. In case of BPCL, they have done like 52.39%. So the percentage will be decided by the government, how much it will be giving to the private sector. Even though net worth and profit increased post privatization for peer firms, why return on assets reduced? So in a long term, they are going to take the total assets. It is not like for one particular year. So assets means you should also retain the profits, whatever you have done in a particular year, as the reserves. You can go back and see the this particular data. So it's the average assets of the company. Again, they have taken this as the average of the peers. So maybe not all the companies are very good in producing the assets. See, even if you create profit, you should be able to retain the profit as the reserves, so that your assets will be slowly starting to building. Every year, to the kind of assets what you are adding, what is the profit after the taxes? So they'll be seeing like that. See, not every year you will be able to produce the same amount of profit after the taxes. You could have accumulated, say for example, a company has like 50 crore worth of assets. You can't say that every year it is actually adding on 50 crores worth of the assets. 1 year it may be adding more, 1 year it may be adding less. So that average is what is given here. So it's like comparing between the total, and it is comparing per year returns. So that's how you have to look at it. And even though then government announced the profit making LIC for strategic disinvestment, ma'am. So there are certain instances where the government decides to disinvest even the profit making companies, mainly to improve the managerial things and the efficiency of it in the future. The conditions why we should be only disinvesting the loss making companies is all over now. Even to improve the efficiency of the profit making companies, these days the government have started going ahead with the disinvestment. So it's not that loss making should be the only condition why we should go ahead for the strategic disinvestment. Why can't the government adopt a private model giving appraisal to increase efficiency of administration rather than preferring to disinvest to the private sector? See, what we have in our hand, we are slowly dissolving it towards the private sector. We can't be completely giving it off to the private sector immediately because of the various reasons, including the protection of the employees and other things. The government may not want to do a complete privatization, or rather it is slowly going ahead towards a privatization through the model of strategic disinvestment. The government does still have control over the PSC which have been disinvested. Yes, to certain extent they will have, because 49% will be still with the government. Can disinvestment be done to Indian sectors outside India, or only within India it is done? We are doing it for within India. So the major things which were there under the low priority sectors and which are performing within India, that is what we are actually going ahead with the disinvestment. Chapter 10. So we are going to look at whether India's GDP growth is overstated, and the answer which is given by the survey is no. Here the chapter starts with the explanation that investment is very, very important for the country to take the economic growth level to a higher growth rate. So even before we get into this chapter, we just want to go back to our basics and then recall to ourselves. GDP growth, we are looking at it as compared to the previous year, how much has this year's GDP increased, which is what we generally call it as the growth rate. But when we are comparing this previous year's GDP growth to the current year's GDP growth, or how much has it increased, we always take the real GDP value. The real GDP value means you would have already compared the GDP to the base year. I hope we all remember the concepts of how do we calculate the real GDP and also the concept of growth rate. So these are the two basics which I would want students to recall even before we get into this chapter. The result and structure contain both private players, ma'am. It implies that there is complete privatization. Gautam, the result and structure is not to have both private players. It is only to show you the previous chapter's thing. It's only to show you the government can give it to a new entity and it will be, that is this, two companies you can take. It is to give more than 51% to the private sector and retain 49% less than that to the government sector. So it's not a complete privatization. In future, if all the strategic sectors are undertaken by privates, will there be any regulation from the government side? All the strategic sectors will not be given to the private. We already said like those which are with less priority only we are going to give. Can disinvestment be done to Indian sectors outside India? I think this we have said like we are doing it for within India. So in this chapter, I am wanting to the students to recall back the two basic concepts. One is about the real GDP concept, which is like comparing the current year's GDP with the base year quantity and the prices, and then see the increase in the real quantity, or the quantity is what is, we call it as the real GDP. And what is GDP's growth rate? You are comparing the growth of the GDP in comparison with the previous year. So these are the two basics which I want all of you to recall. So now going ahead, this particular slide is mainly saying like with the introduction, any country, if its GDP has to improve, we have to give a lot of importance to the investment. And how have we given importance to investment so far is like we have brought in lots of FDI norms relaxation. We are trying to bring in more foreign capital. We are trying to cut the tax rate so that companies will be motivated for further investment. And we are trying to contain the inflation, which will give a very ambience, good ambience for the businesses to go for the investment. And ease of doing business, of course, we have already shown like how we have improved 7 out of the 10 parameters. In the previous chapter, that how we have started doing well when compared with the previous years. So we are showing ourselves as a fastest growing economy. So now we are going to the major question of this chapter, whether India's GDP growth rates are correctly estimated or not. So we are going to go back and see some of the changes which have been made in the calculations. From 2015 onwards, they changed the base year from 2004-05 to 2011-12. And they also started looking at larger databases and differences in the methodology. And they aligned it with the system of national accounts of the UN. So this is the standardized methodology which is being followed to measure GDP across the world. So we have also started aligning ourselves with the with the system of national accounts. So then, though we have taken up the system of national accounts, how are we going to do for our country? This was finalized by the Advisory Committee on National Account Statistics, right? So with these changes, we are going and seeing India versus other countries, how the GDP growth rates have changed. And we are seeing if it was not implemented, what would have been the situation? And if it has, because it has been implemented, how much change of the growth rate has actually happened? So this is basically a bit of an econometric methodology chapter. 2-3 things we need to remember here. First, they are trying this difference in difference methodology. I think we mentioned about this DID in the previous chapter on the privatization, where we said if there is a change before the change, after the change, you are comparing yourself, but you will also be comparing yourself with the peers. Similarly, in this chapter, India is going to be compared with other countries. So the other countries are going to be kept as peers and India will be considered. And we are going to see the changes in the growth rates because of the introduction of the change in the methodology. Right? So that's the first thing, the difference in difference methodology. The second thing what they have attempted is they have tried to do some regression. Regression is to find out like what are all the factors which have resulted in the increase in this growth rate. Say for example, here we have written here it as the suspect variable or the GDP growth rate, right? So that's the dependent, that's what we want to actually find out how this has increased. And correlated with the reliable variables. Independent variables will be like, I have different parameters in the country. I am linking all of these independent variables to the dependent variable. That's one way of looking at it. The third thing what they have done in the chapter is they have studied something which is called as correlation. Correlation is just to see the association between two variables. If you want to say in a very simple term, if you want to talk about like the grains production in the country with the association with the rainfall, so that is seen to be, that should be seen as a positive correlation, or you can say fertilizer application and the production of the food grains. So we are just seeing an association or a correlation. But if you are saying one as the reason for the other thing, that will become into regression, right? You can say that increasing the fertility is the reason for the increase in the food grains, then you are going to say that increase in the food grains as the dependent variable and application of fertilizers as the independent variable. So you are going to say cause and impact, effect, kind of a relationship, that will be regression. But if you are just saying these two variables are just associated positively or negatively, that is called as correlation. So difference in difference methodology, regression, correlation, all of these things are attempted in different ways to show that whether India's methodological change has resulted in a very huge difference in the calculation of the GDP's growth rate or not. So they are trying to justify that we are not overestimating GDP, rather we are doing it methodologically only. So that's the point which the survey wants to make. So we will go and see like what are the methodologies. So here you can say that India versus the other countries. The other countries are presented with the word controls here. You can see the word controls. So we said difference in difference methodology. So first what we will say is if this is India, they are saying like after this methodological change. So from 2011-12 to 2016, taking 11-12 as the base year, as well as the changes in the methodology adopted from the system of national accounts. So taking those things, what is the GDP growth rate? Compared to India's before the methodological change, what was the growth rate? So this is like my country growth rate before and after the changes. Similarly, you can see the controls. Controls is the other countries. So how the other countries' growth rate has changed in the comparable periods. So in a similar period, my methodological change, I am considering it from 2012. So till up to that. So if GDP of India is calculated between 2011 to 2011, similarly, the controls will also be compared in those period. And then you are seeing the difference in the difference methodology. So that is why this is DID. So India, before and after the changes, other countries before and after the changes, and what is the difference between India and the other countries. So that's the final DID. Apart from this, they are also doing one more thing to see whether we are comparing ourselves with the comparable peer group. See, in the last chapter we had a table, and in that particular table we said in a particular industry, in the Hindustan Zinc, and then comparable peers. So that is a point always when you are doing economic analysis. You should be comparing yourself only with the comparable peers. So we are seeing whether India was comparing itself with the comparable peers, which can be seen through this. We'll tell you how it goes. So here this formula has been changed from today India, what is the growth rate? And today, the rest of the countries, what is the growth rate? Then India, what was the growth rate? Then means before this methodological change, what was the growth rate? Compared to what was the growth rate for the other countries in that before the methodological change period. So you can see that this this formula has been completely realigned to the current period minus the before period, right? I hope you are able to understand the difference between the two formulas. So whereas here you can see that now it is the current period after the methodological change, how is India performing versus how are the other countries performing? And similarly, before the methodological change, how India and the other countries were performing. So if India was comparable with the other countries before the methodological change, only then you can compare India with the other countries post the methodological change, because then only you will know that whether they are comparable peers or not. So the whole essence of whether this comparability is possible or not is lying in this formula, whereas this formula is going to say that if it is comparable, how much difference have we arrived at due to the methodological change. So you're going to see the results of these two things. The first diagram you are going to see as a result of this first formula. Here you can see that. So this is India before and after the change, and this is the rest of the countries before and after the change, which is what is given here. So before the change, after the change, before the change, after the change. This is between India and the other countries. And what we said as the difference between India and the other countries, that is what is given here through the dotted line. So this is what is the effect of methodological change on the GDP growth, right? So the blue colored line you can see here, which is what is India's GDP growth before and after. This is the control groups. The green colored line is the control groups before and after. And the difference in the difference, this formulas, this India minus the control group is what is given here as the effect of change in the methodology due to the GDP, change in the newer methodology. They are give the result of this particular formula in this particular graph. So the change in the methodology has resulted in this much of increase in the GDP growth for India. So here is where somewhere they are trying to raise the question that whether India has overestimated its GDP growth after the methodological change, which they are now going to give other substantiation to say it is not. But the second graph is much more important than the first graph, because here we said like India in the current period and India versus the other countries in the previous period. If in the previous period, if they have been comparable, only then you can compare India with the other countries in the current period. So that diagram, you can go here and see that before the methodological change, India was not actually comparable with the other set of countries. So in this case, when you are not comparable in the pre-period, how can you become comparable in the post period is the question. So that's why they say that India does not follow a parallel trend before the treatment, that is before 2012. And it is an imperfect model to measure the misestimation. So now you cannot go and say, compare like this in this particular graph and say that this is what is a methodological change. So you are not supposed to say this. This diagram is not methodologically good to explain the differences. Because in this period, in this before period, India versus the other countries, they were not in comparable pattern. They were not comparable peers. So that's why they say that this difference and difference methodology is not actually giving you the best results here through this first formula, which is trying to answer this question. What's the question? What would have been the estimate of the Indian GDP growth if the methodological change had not been implemented? So which is what they are trying to compare it with the controls, the comparable countries, and then say that what is the difference in the GDP's growth rate due to this methodological change? So which they were attempting to do. So they are saying that this methodology is not good enough to do because it is not substantiated by the comparable pattern before the change. So I cannot take the changes after the change, right? So then what is to be done right now if we can't accept this difference in the difference methodology? So we need to do something else. So that's why they move on to the second point, which they call it as the cross-sectional regression. So when you're talking about regression, we already said that regression is a methodology in which you are going to say there will be a dependent variable and there will be a set of independent variables. You're going to see whether because of these independent variables, this dependent variable increased or not. So the GDP's growth rate has happened because of many of the independent variables. So this you can do like before the methodological change, after the methodological change, in order to see and do the correction of this misestimation. So that's the second methodology which they attempted. So if you just look at this particular graph, they said like India's growth rate is seeming to be overestimated by 2.77%. And when they do the similar kind of a methodology for all other countries also, like taking, say for example, if they want to take it for Germany and then compare it with the rest of the world, when similar methodology is being followed, which methodology, this difference methodology is followed, they were seeing this misestimation was happening with all other countries also. So then the survey is asking a question, if misestimation is happening in all other countries also, then should we start accepting that we are also as part of it and then just leave it at that? Then the survey says, no, we are going ahead and trying to do the corrections of it. We are trying to understand how this GDP growth rate increased in the pre and the post period. We are not only wanting to say that it is due to the methodological change. We want to prove that it is a real improvement in the sectors, and which is why also this GDP's growth rate has improved. We just don't want to mention it as an overestimation. So how have they done it is, they have brought in all the variables. So say, for example, when you're not considering some of the variables in a particular estimation picture, it can result in omitted variable bias. Omitted variable means you didn't consider it and therefore it was not reflecting in it, and therefore you were not able to get good results. So what they were doing is they were putting in all possible sectors, and then they were trying to see whether these sectors' the performance is having impact on the growth rate in the before and the after period. So when they are definitely including service sector and other things, you will know like the performance of the service sector, when it is improving very much, it will be definitely having a very good impact upon the improvement in the growth rate. So to certain extent, by including many variables into the independent variables, they were able to reduce this error. And the second thing is fixed effects model. This is purely an econometric methodology. We are not going into the details of it, but as a layman, we can understand one thing about it. This is a model which will allow one to control for unobserved individual characteristics across countries. So we were saying like, we are not able to compare these two countries before the changes. So we are trying to minimize the differences between these two countries and then run the regression for all the unobserved characteristics also. Then we will be able to reduce the errors and then rerun the regression. And with that, we are saying like this overestimation is going off, and it is seeming that our GDP estimation on the growth rate about the GDP is very correctly estimated. So two things what you can possibly do is put in all the possible variables which you think will be influencing the GDP's growth rate. Number two, reduce the differences between the countries by putting a fixed effects model where you are reducing the differences between the two persons even before you start with the comparison, because you should be comparing only comparable peer group. So all these adjustments are being done in the econometric way. And finally, when you go ahead and do the estimation of the GDP, they are saying now it is neither overestimated nor it is underestimated. Then the third methodology by which they are trying to say that the GDP's estimation is not wrong is, they are, as I told you, the word correlation. Correlation is just an association. In this table, you are seeing positive and negative signs given throughout the table. And you are also seeing some of the indicators here, and they are being correlated with the GDP growth. So what is the meaning of this? We'll tell in a very simple layman's statement. If GDP growth is positive, exports growth should also be positive. Is it necessary? It is not. That is what this table is telling you. You can see that in 1980-84, exports growth was negative, whereas GDP growth was positive. Right? So what they are trying to say in this particular table is, all these variables are having different signs with the GDP growth. It is not necessary that if GDP is growing by 5% or 6%, your imports or your exports or your petroleum will also be growing by 5%, 6%. So they are trying to say that even before that methodological change, which is like 2011-12 only we got the change in the base year and the methodological change we started doing. So till up to that 2005-09 also, you can see that all these, the darkening of the colors. Here also, we were having differences in the behavior of the variables with the GDP growth rate. So if a similar difference you are observing slowly after the period of that methodological change, so you don't have to think that you have done a gross or wrong thing in the calculation of the GDP, because even before this period also, the variables were showing only difference in their behavior in terms of the correlation or in the terms of association. So that is what they have given here in this particular graph. You could see like this will be positive, positive. Here it will be positive and negative. Here both will be negative. This will be again negative and positive. So though the GDP has been growing historically, you can place these different sectors in different locations, which shows that not everything has to be positive in the same direction in order to show that the GDP is growing. And this is again, you want to pick up and see some of the things. Here you can say that the petroleum sector is actually growing negatively, whereas the GDP is growing positively. But electricity sector is growing positively when the GDP growth rate is becoming positive. So that's how we interpret this table. So they have also given this in terms of the diagram where they across a period, they are showing like, say for example, if you pick up this petroleum, the orange colored line, you can see that the petroleum's performance was continuously differing between positive and negative when GDP growth was actually happening in a positive way. So you can see many of the variables are hovering between the positive and the negative. There is no particular definite association between this and that. So if you see 11, 12 also, you are seeing that kind of a difference, then we accept that whatever we are doing today as the methodology for the calculation of GDP is correct only. So there are three things which we have studied through this chapter. One, we say that difference in the difference methodology. But initially, we found that the comparability of the peer group with India as a country is not there. So we again went back and started doing the correction in that comparison by running a regression, by taking the dependent and most of the independent variables to reduce the omitted variable by us, and to put a fixed effect model so that the individual differences between the unseen differences will also be reduced. After making them into comparable peers, when I'm doing this kind of the regression and finding out whether the growth rate is actually correctly estimated, then I am seeing that yes, it is being correctly estimated. So my overestimation, underestimation is reduced. And I am trying to substantiate these methodologies by looking at the correlation as the third methodology, where I want to tell that sectors have been showing differences in their behavior, even though there is a positive growth rate in the GDP, a particular sector had been having a positive or a negative association, which is still continuing even after the methodological change. So the methodological change has not made a very gross wrong estimation of GDP. We are seeing that the GDP's estimation is correct only. So that's what is being given here as the conclusion. Level and growth of a country's GDP is the barometer. So of course, we definitely have to have this variable on GDP in order to understand the economy's performance. And we are connecting it back for the investment, because only if you earn income, a part of it will be going back into the form of the investment. And we should be measuring this GDP as accurately as possible. So now India is saying that we are following the system of national accounts. We have adopted to the changes of the data and to the sources, as well as we have adopted a newer base year. But after adopting all these things and after making lots of corrections in the methodology, we are able to give a precise estimate of the GDP's growth rate. There is no overestimation or underestimation in the GDP's growth rate. So this is what they are summarizing through this chapter. What is the corrections made in the regression? The regression will be, see, if you look at this table, these are all the things, major things which the model wanted to take initially in the difference in the difference methodology and all. So if you see like exports, imports, credit, electricity, petroleum, these are all mostly the manufacturing sector, and you can see exports, imports. So external sector is there, manufacturing sector is there. Secondary and the open sector is there, but you don't find the agriculture and service sector and all. So they are including those kinds of variables also into it in order to understand the impact of those sectors on the GDP and to avoid the omitted variable bias. They don't want to like leave any variable. They want to include all the variables which will be having the impact on the GDP growth. Is there any doubt in this chapter? You can raise your hand, else we go on to the last chapter. Only thing is, you need to understand this before the period, it is not comparable. So we can't compare them after the period also, because this is not good. We won't be able to accept this. Though India shows a change in the methodology and the presentation of the growth rate after that, and comparable peers are also showing a change in their growth rate before and after. The difference in difference methodology result is this dotted line, but we are not accepting this results because of this non-comparable nature. For correcting this only, we are going ahead with the methodological changes and challenges. Recently, the borrowing percentage was increased from 3% to 5% for states from GSVP. Can you explain this? I think we need to get back. If you're talking about borrowing, it is about the fiscal deficit. So basically, we have a targeting for the fiscal deficit, which they are now trying to contain around 3%. GSDP is gross state domestic product. Like the central government is borrowing some percentage of the GDP, like around 3%. States can also borrow from the people. That percentage would have been increased mainly because of the present condition, right? If you want to meet with the expenditure, if you are going ahead for borrowing, the government has a number or a percentage to which you can actually borrow. So, which is called as a fiscal deficit targeting. I hope we all remember back our FRBM Act, where they are giving you targets for how much of total public debt should be there, how much of borrowing should happen. So those percentages have been recently increased, maybe because of the current COVID situation. So now we move ahead to the last chapter, which is upon the Kalinomics. They are going to call it as the economics of a plate of food. So which will be a holistic nutritional requirement for a person. What are they trying to prove this through this chapter is mainly to tell that the food prices have actually come down and affordability has gone up. So they have actually benefited the common man. How this was all possible, they have a methodology to prove it. So for first thing, what they are trying to say is, if there is a plate and then you are keeping several things in the plate, vegetarian, non-vegetarian, they're going to calculate the price of this ingredients in this plate by taking the monthly price, which is for the CPI industrial workers. These days, you may be thinking like CPI is calculated only for the rural and for the urban. But earlier, we used to have CPI for agricultural laborer, rural laborer, industrial worker, urban non-manual employees, varieties of sections of the society. What you are seeing today as the CPI rural, urban, and then finally what you call it as a CPI combined is comparable with the CPI industrial workers. So CPI industrial workers is like still being calculated, and you're going to say take the monthly price for the CPI industrial workers. And how much food a person should be consuming, what should be there in the Kalinomics, it will be like one adult male who is engaged in heavy work, so how much nutrition is required for him, and similarly, how much wages he will be earning. So these are all the basic parameters with which the survey starts with this chapter. And they go ahead with a price construction where we are going to see that what will be there in the plate. So rice and wheat, there will be differences in different states across the country. So the cereals, what are being considered is the rice and the wheat, and vegetables, these are the basic things which they have taken into consideration. The prices of these vegetables will be taken into consideration. Dal, the red gram, Bengal gram, Masoor dal, green gram, black gram, all those things are taken. Fuel, cooking gas, and firewood prices have been taken. In case of your non-veg thali price construction, they have replaced the dal with the non-veg, the rest of the things remaining the same. So there will be egg, fish, and the goat meat. So these are the three things which they have replaced for the dal in the non-vegetarian plate. So now they have constructed the prices. Now they are going to give us some substantiation saying that there were lots of policies and the programs and schemes which came in the agricultural sector, which has actually resulted in the reduction of the prices of the ingredients what we have mentioned in this particular table. So we go and see this here. They are talking about the schemes which they are saying like has improved the efficiency of the agricultural sector and the agricultural markets efficiency. The first thing is about the price support schemes, how they are like helping the farmers with the giving the supporting pricing policies. And Krishi Sinchai Yojana is about how they are helping the farmers through the irrigation facilities. And Fasal Bima Yojana is by giving the insurance for the agricultural crops and the coverage to it. Soil health card is to improve the soil fertility levels because of the repeated growing of the crops and lack of fertility in the soil. And Enam is about the marketing trading platform, which will help to improve the efficiency of selling of the grains and other major agricultural products. National Food Security Mission, again, how they are procuring more of the rice, wheat, pulses and other things. They're asking the farmers to produce them, and then they also want to procure them, mainly because of this National Food Security Act, where they want to give coverage at least to like around 60 to 70% of the population through the Food Security Act. So these are all the schemes which the survey is presenting as the reason to mention that the efficiency of the agricultural sector in terms of production, in terms of soil, in terms of insurance, in terms of like irrigation, in all the ways it has improved. So the production has improved and the prices have also come down, based upon which a plate of the food for the vegetarian and for the non-vegetarian, it has come down. So that's what they are trying to say through the chapter. So here, how do they do the calculation? You can see that there is one household which they say there are 5 members in it, and each member is having 2 thalis per day. So I have just written these numbers into the multiplication: 1 into 5 members into 2 thalis per day into 365 days. So they have to calculate it for a year. And what will be the denominator is, they are saying like individual workers. See, if there are 5 members, we need not assume that all the 5 members will be going for working. So we can say like the parents, they can be like going for working, and their average wages have been taken and it is calculated for a year's time, and that is what is given as the denominator. So what we are saying is, because the prices of the food grains and other things have come down, 10,000 rupees has been gained here. And this, when it is written as the formula, it is like around 6.5% of the individual workers' early, yearly wages. So that much of money they are saving. And for the non-vegetarian, the saving is slightly lesser than the vegetarian, but there also they are seeing that there is a gain here, right? So now if you go and see how they have calculated this, that price of 2 thalis. So here what we have here, no, this thing, into 5, that's for the 5 members. So 5 members in the family, 2 thalis per day into 365 days. So that you can put in the numerator, and daily wages into 365 in the denominator. So this value, they are showing that the vegetarian thali, the prices have fallen. For the non-vegetarian thali also, the prices have fallen. And this is the percentage to the extent which it has fallen, right? So if it was like around 73% in 2009-10, now it is occupying only up to 50% in 2019-20. Similarly, you can see if it was like around 95-96% for the non-vegetarian thali in 2009-10, you can see that it is somewhere around 78% or so for the non-vegetarian thali in 2019-20. So these two graphs and the previous graph, this is to show you that after 2015-16 till up to 2019-20, the latest year only, they are showing that there is again a mild increase in the prices. Other than that, there is definitely a reduction in the prices of the food grains, which should have gone ahead like this. But after the implementation of this policies and the schemes and other things, this has actually started falling. So this is the explanation which is given in order to show that how much money these people are saving in terms of their denominator, which is the average yearly wages. And they have also gone ahead on a regional way to explain like which states are all having greater affordability or that proportion. So here you can see that share of a day's wage of a worker needed to afford 2 vegetarian thalis for a household of 5 individuals in 2019-20 for the recent year. So the price, the wage per day and the thali price here, and then There are certain no data, 0 to 25, 25 to 50, 50 to 70. So these are all like cheaper areas, but this will be a bit costlier area. And here, similarly, you can see it also for the non-vegetarians, right? So here also you can see like which are all the areas which are like costlier, right? And what they are trying to say from these data is from 2015-16 to 2019-20, prices of cereals, vegetables and dal has decreased. But in the recent period, April to October, there was an escalation in the prices. However, the overall affordability of the thalis against a day's pay of a worker has improved over time, indicating improved welfare of the common person. And I think somewhere it was mentioned in the highest gain in any year was given in the southern region for a vegetarian thali, which was like around 12% of the annual earnings of a worker. So they are calculating year after year how much percentage gains they have made because of the fall in the prices. You should just assume the data something like this. In 2009-10, if there was a price, and in 2019-20, there is the wages, and similarly, the prices are not decreasing. If it is remaining the same, this percentage wouldn't have come down. So two things you can think about in this calculation. Either the prices have come down in a larger way, or the yearly wages have actually increased over a period of time. We can't rule out the denominator's role also in this. See, if you are comparing your wages between 2009-10 and 2019-20, definitely there will be an increase in the wages between these two periods. But the government's claim or the survey's claim is that there has also been reduction in the prices, and there, which has resulted in increased affordability of the thalis are the plate of the food, what they want to describe here as the thalinomics. So they are trying to show like how the prices have actually declined for cereals between 2015-16 and 1920. This is for sabji, is about the vegetables. So that has also fallen down. So for dal also it has fallen down. For non-vegetarian prices have also come down fuel. So these are all the things which are actually going into the calculation as we showed in the first table of this chapter. So all of these things are having a decline in this, except for the recent past, which they said about like 2019-20. So when we consider the given data, we need to accept the fact that the prices have actually fallen down. We can also keep in the mind the fact that the yearly wages would have increased. So by the combination of both of these things, we can say that the affordability has actually started increasing. The vegetarians' affordability is seeming to be like they have actually gained 6.5% when compared to the 5.6% of the individual workers' yearly wages, right? So the gain to the vegetarians is higher, and particularly to the southern region, it is very higher. So that is about the thalinomics. If you have any doubt in this chapter, you can ask. Otherwise, we are done with the volume one. Instead of speaking gains, why can't they show how much the average cost is reduced? That they have not given directly here. They are, of course, somewhere you can also figure out that particular kind of reduction in the cost through these kinds of diagrams, which if it in a straight line, it should have increased like this, but the vegetarian thali prices have come down because of that last graph also you can think like, cereals prices have come down, sabji's prices have come down. So this is one of the evidences which can be answered to the question that how the prices have actually fallen down. Prices are basically based upon the cost. So we can be taking this as an answer for this question. There are more questions. Are these thali calculations based on calorie factor or any others, ma'am? Actually, a plate of thali should be giving enough of nutrition to a person. That's why in the first thing we said, one slide we said about the adult person doing heavy work. So there will be some norms for a basic minimum nutrition requirement. Based on that only, they would have decided the cereals, the vegetables, and the dal to be had. So definitely calorie will be a factor, but they have not explicitly mentioned in the chapter like how much calorie for that, how much thali, that kind of a presentation has not been added here. I think with that, we are closing this session. So next week, Monday, again, we'll have a class on the economic survey, volume 2. We'll start with the first 4 to 5 chapters, and hopefully in another one more session, we'll be able to complete.